Look to the Lord and his strength. Seek his face always. For the Lord your God is God of gods and Lord of lords, the great, the mighty, and the awesome God. Great is the Lord in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations. Let us praise his great and marvelous name. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. Sing to him. Sing praises to him. Tell of all his wonderful acts. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among all peoples. These are the kind of worshipers the Father seeks. A time has now come when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. We will praise the Lord at all times. We will constantly speak his praises.
Good morning, Cross Cocoa Church. I would like to invite you once again this morning to join us in worship. We're going to exalt his name and declare that God is our strength. You know, some of you might have had a rough week, but God is faithful. He's our strength. He's a good God. So as we sing this song, join me. Let's all stand up as we worship him.
Have I in heaven but you? There is nothing on earth I desire besides you. My heart and my strength, many times they fail, but there is one truth, but there is one truth that always will prevail. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever, forever.
Come on, join me one more time as we sing the first verse.
Whom have I in heaven but you? There is nothing on earth I desire besides you.
Hallelujah, my heart and my strength.
My heart and my strength.
Many times they fail.
Many times they fail.
There is one truth,
but there is one truth that always will prevail. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart and my portion. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart. God is the strength of my heart and my portion forever, forever, forever.
sing that part again. My heart and my strength. Many times they fail.
Many times they fail.
Hallelujah. But there is one truth.
But there is one truth. That always will prevail.
One more time, my heart and my strength.
My heart and my strength.
Many times.
Many times they fail.
There is one truth.
But there is one truth. That always will prevail.
For nothing, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, present your request to God. And the peace of God that transcends all understanding will guard our hearts and our minds in Jesus. Lord, this moment as we are gathered individually in our own homes or wherever, there's no distance in prayer. Our spirit can communicate with your spirit because of the Holy Spirit. And this morning, God, we pray, or this day we pray, dear Lord, that we come to your presence with a grateful heart, thanking you for all the wonderful things that you have given to us. And we pray, dear Lord, that you will visit every need that is being represented in this meeting, dear God. Lord, that you will meet us to our point of need, whatever circumstance, situations we are all undergoing, that Lord, you will just supply our needs. May it be emotional strength. May it be healing in the body. May it be peace of mind. May it be opportunities, Lord. We pray that you will just grant faith to your people this morning. We pray, dear Lord, that your powerful presence, dear God, will be in this place, in this hour, this moment in our lives. Lord, we know when we look around us, there are so many things going on. But Lord, when we look above, we can see the brightness of your promise. That Lord, you're a God who never lies. That it's impossible for you to lie. That you said in your word, dear God, that in the name of Jesus, it is yes and amen to them that believe. So we believe in Jesus' name, Lord, that you will intervene in all of our circumstances. And Lord, we are praying for those people who are not feeling well, that you grant them healing in Jesus' name. That you will restore relationships right now in Jesus' name. All the tensions, oh God, you can release. And Father God, we just thank you for this time where we can open our hearts and our minds, that we can listen to your word and mix it with faith so that your miracles will take place. And Lord, have your way in our midst today. We are believing and expecting miracles, Lord, today as we receive your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you.
Welcome to our series, From the World to the Word, dealing with current issues with God's timeless truth. The entire series talks about how we can change our worldview according to God's point of view, that is, through His words, the Bible. We divided the series by sections. The first one, we talked about your belief matters. Because your beliefs are your worldview. Your worldview is the way you look at the world. Your worldview is how you see life, how you see death, how you see yourself. Your worldview includes how you see God and others and money and sex and the past and the present and the future and every area of your life. Your worldview is not only a lens that you see through things, but also determines your behavior. Because your standpoint is where you stand. It is where you build your life upon. You are what you think. What you think, you are. Who you think, you are. You either build your house upon a rock or sinking sand. So are your beliefs. Will either stand out or blown out during the storms of life. Our belief not only determines our behaviors, but also will dictate our destiny. Because you will be judged not only by your thought life, but also your walk in life. Your behavior in life will determine your eternal destiny, heaven or hell. It is something that you can't gamble by chance or simply sincerity, but you have to be sure. Everybody has a worldview, whether they realize it or not. Everybody is entitled to his or her own opinion, but the question always lies, where will it take you in the end? The worst part of life is when you got it all wrong in the end, where all regrets live. Like climbing a ladder, realizing at the top that you are on the wrong building. Don't build your life on temporary things, but lasting things. Jesus said, heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will not pass away. Matthew 24, verse 35. The only way to be sure about life and the afterlife is the life manual of truth called the Bible, the infallible Word of God. That's why we continued with the series from Belief Matters to Truth Matters, that our beliefs should be based on absolute truth and the truth that will last. The truth of the matter is that we live in a broken world with broken people. And in this broken world because of sin, God sent Jesus Christ as the cure for sin. There's another topic for that, but let me just emphasize that Jesus is the answer to this broken world and broken life, because mankind was separated from God because of sin, and Jesus bridged the gap between man and God. And God Himself reconciled us to Himself when I said this in my previous teachings. I would like to reiterate that we are now living in the end times. Let's read in Hebrews chapter 1, verse 1 to 2. In the past, God spoke to our forefathers through the prophets at many times and in various ways. But in these last days, He has spoken to us by His Son, whom He appointed heir of all things and through whom He made the universe. This verse tells us that 2,000 years ago, the last days already started. Jesus lived in a more oppressing times than we do. He lived in a time when His homeland was an occupied territory by the Romans, a country that has been captured 52 times and recaptured 44 times, its capital, Jerusalem, besieged 24 times. The first coming of Jesus Christ initiated the beginning of the last days. That was 2,000 years ago. Then we are not just in the last days, but we are in the last of the last days. Let me point out to you a scripture, what the Apostle Paul says in 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 1 to 5. But mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love, unforgiving, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not lovers of the good, treacherous, rash, conceited, lovers of pleasures rather than lovers of God, having a form of godliness but denying its power. What make it terrible? Because this happens not among unbelievers or non-Christians, but among Christians, because it says, having a form of godliness but denying its power. It means Christians waving the Christian flag, even talking Christianese, yet waltzing with sin. When sinners sin, it is understandable. But for the saints to deny its power to overcome sin is terrible. How do you know you are not in any of these category? How should we live? Fortunately, God sent us a model, Jesus Christ, because it says here, those who say they live in God should live their lives as Jesus did in 1 John chapter 2, verse 16. It's kind of obvious, yet we don't do it. We call ourselves followers of Christ. We call ourselves believers. We call ourselves Christians, but we don't always live the way Jesus did. I said before, it's easier to die a Christian, but it's hard to live as one. The big question then is, if I'm to be in the family of God, I'm to live as Jesus Christ did, how do you do that? What does it mean to live as Jesus did? Jesus is the perfect model for living. He not only showed us how to do it, He gave us specific instructions. How do I learn to live like Jesus Christ? Firstly, To live like Jesus means to live with discernment. What that means is that you have to evaluate things. Discernment. You test things. You are discerning. You just don't automatically accept what somebody tells you. You check it out. Be careful with who you listen to. The fruit of every friendship should be righteousness and holiness. You don't automatically accept the world's values. You're not sucked in by popular culture because that's what everybody is doing and cool. Don't be deceived or be impressed who's got the most followers. Jesus has no Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram, but has the most followers. A soccer player had 360 million followers in Instagram, but Jesus has 3 billion followers. And who would you follow? You will end up whatever you follow if you don't have godly discernment. Check things out. You ask things like, is this the truth? Does this square with reality? Is it God's worldview? Or is it just at most a passing fad? Let's read in Romans chapter 12, verse 2 from the Passion Translation. Stop imitating the ideals and opinions of the culture around you, but be inwardly transformed by the Holy Spirit through a total reformation of how you think. This will empower you to discern God's will as you live a beautiful life, satisfying and perfect in His eyes. You are to be discerning and not just automatically believe everything that you hear or see or experience in life. You don't need to be a cynic or a critical of all things, but careful enough to use your mind and God-given common sense. We are to watch that comes to the entry points of our soul. What we see, what we hear, and how we feel. We have to protect what is in the inside, our soul, our mind, our emotion, and our freedom to choose. Jesus warned his disciples to always watch. In Mark chapter 14, verse 38, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The Bible is full of warning with statements like, watch out, see to it, don't be ignorant, and so on and so forth. The problem is we are bombarded now by media, radio, television, internet, iPods, and on, billboards and movies, everything that's constantly hitting us. After a while, you kind of let your guard down and you start letting stuff into your mind that you wouldn't even agree with, that you know it's wrong. For instance, have you ever found yourself singing a song with words that are the exact opposite of your values? What's happening? Sometimes people are putting their worldview into our minds because they have a good tune. Today's entertainment is normalizing the immoral as reality and call it a show. Without moral comparison, it becomes normal and desensitizes your ability to disgust on disgusting things. Jesus says you need to be discerning and know what you're allowing in your mind. You may be thinking at times that you are doing the right thing, but you might be operating off the world's value system that's been programmed into your mind through YouTube, television, music, playlists, and books, and you're brainwashed. And you just automatically think this is the right way to do it. Jesus warned, make sure that the light you think you have is not actually darkness. Luke 11, 35. But be discerning. The Bible also says in Proverbs 14, verse 12, there is a way that appears to be right, but in the end it leads to death. So the first thing is that we must be discerning. We must examine everything that goes through our ears, our eyes, and the way we feel. we must discern them according to the truth. The first thing to walk like Jesus in this messed up world is discernment, and the second is humility. In order to have the ability of discernment, one has to have humility. Why is humility important? For two reasons. Because humility attracts the grace of God. Grace means favor. Humility attracts the favor of God, the grace of God. In 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 6, it says there, God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. God resists the proud, but gives grace to the humble. Humility attracts the grace of God, and the grace of God is a teaching grace. Let me show you in Titus chapter 2, verse 11. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It teaches us to say no to ungodliness and worldly passions, and to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age. Therefore, humility is the precursor of discernment, because discernment is the product of being teachable. Being teachable is to be pliable to the molding process of God, and the molding process of God prepares you for future troubles of life. The grace of God teaches and trains us to be prepared. In Proverbs chapter 1, the wisdom of God is calling us to hear and heed God's teachings. Let me read. Repent at my rebuke, then I will pour out my thoughts to you. I will make known to you my teachings. But since you refuse to listen when I call, and no one pays attention when I stretch out my hands, since you disregard all my advice and do not accept my rebuke, when calamity overtakes you like a storm, when disaster sweeps over you like a whirlwind, when distress and trouble overwhelm you, then they will call to me, but I will not answer. They will look for me, but will not find me, since they hated knowledge and did not choose to fear the Lord. Since they would not accept my advice and spurn my rebuke, they will eat the fruit of their ways and be filled with the fruit of their schemes. Now, let me emphasize this verse. It says, when calamity overtakes you like a storm, when disaster sweeps over you like a whirlwind, when distress and trouble overwhelm you, they will call upon me, but I will not answer. They will look for me, but will not find me. In this verse, God is not being mean, where he doesn't want to be found during periods of distress. He's able to save and mighty to save. But the ability to have wisdom and the ability to trust God to navigate in the storm is a rehearsed process, not a desperate process. Listen carefully. The Bible is talking about being prepared for calamity by having a prior working relationship with God. In life, we expect the best, but we also prepare for the worst. It's too late to start training for the marathon after the starting gun has gone off. It's too late to take a course on sailing when the storm has just swept over you. You already need to have a seaworthy boat and knowledge of sailing. It's too late to dig a well when you are thirsty. And it's too late once the inevitable sorrows of life come out of nowhere and would knock you to your knees, and you would say, well, now I guess it's better time to be close to God in order that I'll get through this. One doesn't whip up a deep relationship with God out of thin air in a moment of crisis. You have to already know God. You have to already know God and be in a relationship with him before the storms arrive. Otherwise, the crisis leaves no room to develop the kind of confidence in God and his character that will see you through. He's not a genie in a bottle to fulfill your last desperate wish. And he's also not a bellman you can call that you would want him to carry out all the luggages with you in your mess. If God isn't the thing you want most, if there is something else, when that thing is threatened, you will go to pieces. When you are in times of comfort and calm, it's time to prepare as the calm before the storm. Being humble, teachable, and being pliable to the words of God will help you weather the storm when they come. Having humility and discernment will always enable you to take the high road of life, that is, dependence on God. The difference between a Christian and non-Christian in this messed up world is how they approach crisis, troubles, and the maladies of life. One panics while the other prays in peace. Why? Because Christians depend on God. The second reason humility is important in life is that it makes you depend on God and not on yourself. In a word, humility is dependence. Humility is dependence on God. The more humble you are, the more you depend on God and the less you depend on yourself. That's what humility is all about. That's why the very first beatitude in the very first Sermon on the Mount, Jesus said, "Blessed are those who are poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God." What does it mean to be poor in spirit? It means humble. Poor in spirit means, God, I admit I don't have it on my own. If I'm going to make it in life, I'm going to need you. God, I'll never accomplish what you want me to accomplish. I'll never reach my dream. I'll never be the man or the woman you want me to be unless you help me out. That's being poor in spirit. That's being humble, acknowledging God, saying, God, I can do it on my own. Why is humility so important? Because without humility, you will have so much stress in your life. The reason why you get stressed out is a lack of humility. What do I mean by that? There are two greatest causes of stress. These are, number one, you want to take control of the uncontrollable. You want to take control of everything. Trying to control things that you can't control gets you stressed out. It gets you worried. The truth is, most of your life is out of control. You can control your attitude, you can control your response, but you can't control what's going to happen to you next week. You have no control over what's going to happen to you to the rest of your life. Those circumstances are beyond your control, so you get stressed out. The more you need control, the more stressed you get. The need to control is an evidence of insecurity. When you see somebody who has a high need for control, it means one thing. They have high insecurity. The more insecure a person is, the more they try to control everything because they are afraid. They don't want you to know they're afraid, but they're trying to control it so they don't have to be afraid. The more confident you are, the more relaxed you are. You hold things with an open hand. Your confidence is not based on having to control everything. You get stressed because you try to control the uncontrollable. So there's a saying, let go and let God. The second source of stress is the lack of trust in God. Whenever you don't trust God, your stress goes up, your worry goes up, your anxiety goes up, and your peace of mind goes away. It just falls apart. So you're depending on yourself instead of depending on God. That is the major cause of stress. What is the antidote to stress? The antidote is humility. In Matthew chapter 11, verse 29, Jesus said, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls." He said, take my yoke upon you. He's not talking about an egg yolk. He's talking about the thing that attaches oxen or horses together to pull a cart. What's the purpose of a yoke? To have the burden. So the purpose of a yoke is to make the load lighter. God never meant for you to go through life pulling things on your own, pulling the burden of your life all by yourself. That's why you're tired all the time. You're trying to solve all your problems by yourself. God never meant for you to live that way. Jesus says, yoke up with me. Put my yoke on you and we'll pull your load together. He's got a lot more strength than you do. Now here's the thing about it. When you pull the yoke together, you have to go at the same pace Jesus goes. When you are pulling the load of your life all by yourself, you have the tendency to go fast. You have a tendency to go in the wrong direction, and you have a tendency to pull off in a ditch. Some of you have been there several times. When you are yoked to Jesus, then He's pulling it with you. It's lighter. He's going to go just the right pace because He knows the pace better than you do. He's going to keep you in the right direction. And there's no way He's going to let you go off in a ditch. He says this, come to me, all you who are weary. You're burdened, you're worn out, you're tired, you're stressed. He said, and I will give you rest. And He continued, take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart. And what does humility produce? You will find rest for your souls. If you're stressed out today, the answer to your stress are the three things in that verse. He said, come to me. That means come to Christ. He said, take my yoke upon you. That means give up control and learn of me. Learn to trust. Come to Christ, give up control, learn to trust. That's it. That's the antidote to stress. Come to Christ, give up control, learn to commit everything to Him, trusting everything to Him. You may have to do that many times a day. God, I'm bringing you this problem. Jesus, I'm bringing this problem to you. I'm giving up control of this. I'm not going to worry about it. I'm going to trust you. You do that and your stress level goes down. Coming to Christ, giving up control and learning to trust. There's another word for that. Humility. That's real humility. Let me just summarize. You need discernment and wisdom to navigate this life. And the only way to get proper discernment is by humility, because it invites the grace of God. And the grace of God is a teaching grace, teaching the wisdom of God to weather the storms in this messed up world. If we live in this messed up world, yours doesn't have to be messed up. In order for you to live in this messed up world, so you have to have discernment. And discernment can only be attained through humility. God gives us the grace to know, because the grace of God is a teaching grace. Therefore, we must humble ourselves. Humility, as a matter of fact, is a choice. Although it is mostly introduced by trying circumstances, but you don't need circumstances to train you. Be yoked with Jesus, the wisdom of God. The Bible says, James chapter 4, verse 10, humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and He shall lift you up. Humility is a choice. It's a command that requires a choice. You don't pray to God, God, make me humble. No. The Bible says, humble yourselves and walk like Jesus. As you humble yourself today, as you do, you would know how to handle every storm and crisis that comes your way. Are you in a storm right now? We could have a never-ending storm inside of us without Him. Jesus is the only one who can calm the storm. If He won't calm the storms with His power, He will calm you with His peace. Do you want this peace? He's the peace in this troubled world. You need Jesus Christ. Make this prayer and let Jesus come to change your world, to change your worldview. Let's pray. Father in heaven, there is a cure for life's troubles. You sent your word to guide us and lead us, the Bible. You also sent forth your Son, the living word, to save us from our sins. Jesus, fill us today. Fill our lives with your peace. We invite you to come into our hearts and calm our storms and fill the void of our empty hearts. Forgive us of our sins as we reject them and have you lord over the throne of our hearts in humility. We choose to humble ourselves, to come to you and commit our lives to you by trusting in you. We invite you to invade our circumstances and help us overcome them. In your name we pray. Amen. God bless you. As you followed me with that prayer, God invades your life. He will overwhelm you with His love, and you will overflow with His love and peace. God bless you. Bye.
We hope you're blessed by this message. And if you have any prayer requests, please send them to us at
prayers@theccchurch.com.
See you again next week, and don't forget to send the link to your friends and family.
And remember this, you are loved and prayed for. God bless and be safe. Balboa Boulevard, Northridge, California, 91325. Cut.
Good job, you did it.